Welcome back, YouTube. In this video, I'm going to show you how to make enemies perform ranged and melee attacks while also doing damage to your player. More specifically, the ranged attack will be in the form of this enemy firing a cannonball, and the melee attack will be this enemy spinning a blade around their body, and both of them will be chasing the player and only attacking when they are within range of the player. Real quick, if you find this video helpful, please consider liking and subscribing as it helps me out tremendously, and it helps you stay up to date on all my latest tutorials. I'm Reedster with Far Gaming, and now, let's get started. So first off, I want to explain some basic things I have going on in the scene. I have some walls put around the scene, and then this plane has a nav mesh surface attached to it, because my player and both of the enemies have nav mesh agents on them, and that's how they're going to move around the scene and get where they're going, just wherever that nav mesh surface is going to allow them to move to. Taking a look at my player, you'll see I have a player movement script that allows me to click somewhere in the scene, and that is where my player is going to move to. I can hold the mouse down if I want to, or I can just click and the player is going to move there. That's how I'm going to control where my player is going. And as I said, I do have a nav mesh agent attached to both the player as well as both of the enemies. And then on the enemies, they have a simple AI controller script that tells them to move to wherever the player is. They look for the player, and that is the position that they move to. Each of the enemies are going to have a set stopping distance so that they're not moving all the way up to the player and like bumping into them. They're going to keep a little bit of distance, but they're going to get up to that distance away from the player. Also on my ranged enemy, you'll see I have the cannon that is on top of them, as well as a cannonball that is actually inside the cannon already. This is more for appearances and not necessarily the actual cannonball that's going to be fired out of the gun. I'll touch on that a little bit more in a bit. But for now, we'll see that if I hit play, then the enemy will move towards my player, and I can click around the scene and move them wherever I want to. The cannon doesn't move, nothing else special happens other than the enemy is following my player. And one last thing I want to point out is that I do have a canvas added to my scene. This allows me to display the player's current health on like a user interface on the actual game. But currently, our player can't take any damage, and there's no way of updating this player health number on the screen. So we're going to touch on all of that as we go through it. So the first thing that I want to work on is making it so that my ranged enemy will actually attack my player. The way I'm going to accomplish that is with this cannon on top. No matter which way the enemy is facing, because they're always going to be facing the direction that they're moving towards, I want this cannon to be able to rotate towards the player whenever the enemy is within a certain range of the player. I'm also going to add a dash of realism in here by making it so that my cannon isn't always super accurate. It's not only going to fire if it's looking directly at the player. It may fire if it's looking a little bit to the left or a little bit to the right of the player. But no matter what, the cannon is always going to try to turn and look directly at the player. This will also allow for scenarios where maybe the player is moving to the right and the cannon fires a little bit early, and then the player moves in front of the cannonball and gets hit, or maybe the player's moving away from it and then they get to dodge it. So it adds a dash of realism in there, which I think will make it kind of neat. So the first thing I'm going to need to do to my ranged enemy is add a sphere collider to them. Here I'll set the radius to 10, and then I'm going to say that it is a trigger. So this is basically going to be my area where if the player ends up in this area, then the cannon is now going to target that player. So this is kind of the range of that cannon and when it's going to track and target the player. Next, I'm going to add a script that I made called Cannon Controller. And then I'll open this up and walk you through how it's going to work. I have all of my variables up here at the top, which you'll understand more about those as I'm going through this. The first piece I'm going to really talk about is the onTriggerStay method. If you don't fully understand the onTrigger methods, I have a video dedicated just for those. So go watch that one and then come back here. That should really help you out a lot. But essentially, the sphere collider that we added to the enemy, the really large one that I said was going to be the range of the cannon, once the player starts colliding with that one, then this is going to run. And first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to check if the tag of the other thing that is colliding with that sphere is the player. If so, Then I want to find out what the current angle between the enemy and the player is. Which way does my cannon need to face in order to be facing the player? So that's what all of this right here does. And then after I get that rotation, then I'm going to gradually rotate the cannon towards the player. Next, I mentioned I am going to have a little bit of a range where the cannon will fire even if it's not looking directly at the player. So that's what I'm going to find out here is what the current angle of the cannon is versus the target rotation where I want it to be looking towards, which is the player. So I'm going to get that angle between those two different rotations. And then if we look up here at the top, I say that my firing angle threshold is 5F. So as long as the angle is less than 5, then this part of the if statement is going to evaluate to true. Next, I'm checking how long it's been since the last shot was fired, and I have a variable time between shots. I'm gonna end up setting that to 3 so that it's 3 seconds between shots. And then every time a shot is fired, I'm resetting the time since last shot to 0. And you'll see in the update function, every single time a frame happens, I am adding how many seconds have passed between the frames. So essentially, if the time since last shot is 3 or greater, then that part is also going to evaluate to true. So if both of these conditions equal true, then we are going to run a function called fireCannon. And like I said, set the time since last shot equal to 0. Let's take a look at the fireCannon function. I've put it down here at the bottom. The first thing that this does is create a brand new cannonball using a cannonball prefab that I have in my assets folder. So it takes that prefab, creates a brand new game object with it in the scene, and then it's going to put it at the position of a stationary cannonball, which is the one actually positioned inside the cannon that I said was just there for visuals. I'm going to then get the rigid body component off of that ball since I want this ball to be affected by gravity and actually act like a cannonball. So I'm going to grab the rigid body component, and then as long as it does have a rigid body, then I'm going to add a force to it, which is going to propel it forward, multiplied by the launch force, which is a variable I'll be setting in a moment. One issue I ran into with the 3D model that I made is technically the front of the cannon is actually the backside where it's just a flat face. So instead, I'm going to have to use a negative value for the launch force to send it in the opposite direction out of what it considers to be the back. But that's actually going to be the front of the cannon where I have the hole opening for it. So that's just an issue with the 3D model that I made. And then very last, I'm going to say to destroy that new cannonball after 3 seconds have passed. That way I don't just have a bunch of cannonballs staying around in the scene forever. They will disappear after 3 seconds if they don't hit anything. Now, if they do hit something, each cannonball has this cannonball destroyer script attached to it. And all this does is if the cannonball collides with anything, then it is going to destroy the cannonball. Which overall, I feel like this will make it a little bit more visually appealing and kind of makes sense rather than having the cannonball bounce off of objects. If you think about video games with pirate ships fighting each other, when the cannonball hits the other ship, it doesn't just bounce off the ship or go inside the ship and sit in there. It disappears and you get a little explosion animation. I'm skipping the explosion animation part, but I am having the ball disappear. Going back to the cannon controller script, I have a couple more things. On trigger exit, so when the player leaves that sphere collider that we set up, then I'm going to set a variable called rotate back equal to true. And what this is going to do is in the late update function, which runs after all the trigger methods and the other update function, if rotate back is equal to true, then I'm going to tell the cannon, hey, look back forward towards the front of the enemy. So that way the enemy's not moving around and the cannon's always looking to the left or looking to the right. If the player is not nearby, the cannon's going to kind of reset and look back forward to whichever way the enemy is looking. So the first part of this if statement is just checking if the direction the cannon is facing is greater than 0.1 away from the front of the enemy, the way that we want it to look. If so, then it's just telling it to rotate towards looking at the front of the enemy. Else, if it is pretty much looking at the front of the enemy already, then we're going to set rotate back to false so it'll stop moving. So hopefully everything I've explained in the script made sense to you. This is the most complex script I have in this entire tutorial. So if this one made sense to you, everything else should be a complete breeze. Now let's jump back over to our Unity editor where we have some public variables that just need to be filled in. First, I need to grab the cannon game object and throw it in there. And then I'll grab the cannonball prefab. Next is the stationary cannonball that is for visuals. so that we know where to spawn the cannonball prefab at. I'm now going to set the launch force of the cannon to 1200. Time between shots is going to be 3 for 3 seconds, and the rotation speed I'm going to just set to 50 for now. And now we'll give it a quick test, so we'll hit the play button, and as soon as the player enters the sphere collider, that cannon is going to track and start following the player around. As long as the cannon is at least looking very close to the general direction of the player, it's going to fire a cannonball every 3 seconds. But now we need to add in the functionality so that it's actually doing damage to our player. So I'm going to go to the player and scroll down and add a component, and I'm going to add a player health script that I've created, and then we'll open it up and take a look at it. So like I said, this script is going to be much more simple than the last one. I'm going to start off with a onTriggerEnter method that is going to run the very moment that another trigger collider collides with the player. And then the very first thing I'm going to do is compare the tag of that other object and see if it is called projectile. And this is actually the tag that I've put on the cannonball prefab that was in the assets folder. So if the object that is colliding with our player has the tag projectile, then we're going to subtract 1 from the player's health. And then we're going to get the component renderer and grab the material. And then we're going to set it equal to player damage material. So whenever the player gets hit, they're going to change color a little bit just to indicate that they've been hit. And then after that, I'm going to invoke another method called reset material with a time delay of 0.5 seconds. This reset material function is very straightforward. All I do is I set the material back to the normal player material. So it's going to change to a damage, like showing that it's taking damage color. And after a 0.5 second delay, it's going to turn back to its normal color. The last thing I'm doing in the script is in the update function. Once every frame, I am setting the health UI text that was on the screen equal to whatever the player's health is in this script. And I've also got to convert that to a string since it is an integer type. So that is going to just display whatever the current player health is on the screen and keep that updated. So once again, we'll go back to our Unity editor and take care of our public variables. I'm going to set the player health equal to 50. And then I've got to grab the health UI text inside the canvas, which is this current health. That is the number 50 that's displayed here. So I'm going to grab that and set it equal to the health UI public variable. And then I'm going to go to my materials folder and look for the regular player material, which is this color, drag it over there, and then grab the player hit color that I made and add that to the player damage material. Now we can do a quick demo to see if that is working properly. So it should be whenever the player gets hit with a cannonball, their health is going to go down, and the player's color is going to change for only 0.5 seconds. And we see that works as we wanted it to. So now that we have a working ranged enemy and a way to do damage to our player and keep track of that, let's now move our attention over to the melee enemy. So I'm going to enable that one and disable the ranged enemy. Again, my goals with this one are for it to take the blade that's attached to its body, and whenever it is within a certain distance of the player, I want it to start spinning that around its body at a certain speed, and whenever the blade makes contact with the player, to do damage to the player. So I'll take a look at my current setup, and all I have is the AI controller script and the NavMesh agent. So I'm going to add a component called melee controller. And we'll open up that script to take a look at it. Starting with our onTriggerEnter method, I'm comparing the tag of whatever it is colliding with and seeing if that is the player. If so, I'm setting attacking equal to true. And then as long as attacking equals true, then this will evaluate to true and the blade is going to rotate based on my rotation speed multiplied by time.delta time. And then if the player ever gets too far away where it's no longer in the bubble of the melee enemy, then we're going to say attacking equals false. And then we also have a start method at the very beginning that just sets attacking equal to false at the very beginning. So once again, we'll go back to our Unity editor and take care of our public variables. I'm going to set the rotation speed to 300. And then I need to grab the blade off of the melee enemy and set that to the blade public variable. One last thing I'm gonna need to do is add a sphere collider to our melee enemy so they know when to start spinning the blade around. So I'm gonna click add component and add a sphere collider. I'm going to click the is trigger button and give it a radius of 4, because I only want them to start swinging it whenever they get right there next to the player, but not necessarily only when they're going to be hitting the player. With all of this set up, we can now do our demo to make sure everything is working. I'll hit the play button, and you'll see as soon as the melee enemy gets close to the player, they'll start spinning the blade around, and it works the way that we want it to. Now, something that you'll notice is the player health is not going down, and that's because the blade doesn't have a tag of projectile, because it's not a projectile. So I need to make a change to the player health script so that it's also going to update the player's health whenever it comes in contact with a blade. So going back to the player and opening up the player health script, so all I have to change here is the conditions inside the if statement. So I'm going to come in here and add an or statement and say if the other compare tag, and I'm looking for the tag of blade, finish off the parentheses there. And now whether it is a blade or a projectile that's colliding with the player, it's going to run the conditions inside of this if statement. So I'm going to save the changes to that script and go back to our Unity editor. And real quick, I'm going to scroll down and just check on my public variables, because for some reason my player health reset. So I'm going to set that back to 50, and now we can give it another test. And this time, whenever the player gets close enough to the enemy, they will start getting hit with the blade and taking damage. So I'll go back in and turn on the ranged enemy one more time and do one final demo. So whenever I hit play, we'll see that both enemies are going to chase the player around the scene, and they're only going to attack them whenever they are within range. So we'll see that the melee guy is not actually spinning the blade around unless he gets close to the player. And same way with the cannon, it goes back to that forward facing position unless it is within range of the player. That's all for this tutorial. Remember to like and subscribe if you found this video helpful, and let me know in the comments what tutorials you'd like to see next. Thanks for watching, and I'll catch you on the next one.